Shashi Tharoor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm sorry to say that I rise to oppose the Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Amendment Bill. I find it violative of two very important urgings of our Constitution. Article 51A, which says it's a fundamental duty of every citizen of India to value and preserve our rich and composite culture, and Article 59, which places the duty upon the state to protect historical sites and ancient monuments. This duty is enshrined in the 2010 bill which the government is seeking to amend. In that bill, we created statutory buffer zones of about 100 meters around each protected monument as a prohibited area in which construction was completely banned, and then a further 200 meters as a regulated area in which there was a protective buffer zone, Mr. Chairman, so that we could actually investigate whether construction would be appropriate. So construction, reconstruction, repair, renovation was possible, but only with the approval of the competent authority. While replying to the debate that took place in this House back during the passage of the 2010 amendment in law, the then Minister of Culture, my good friend Mr. Veerappa Moily, who's sitting right next to me today, 7 years ago, he made it very clear that the legislative intent was to completely prohibit construction within the prohibited area, and he specifically said this does mean that future governments will have to plan projects in such a way that it will not require and not permit any interference in the prohibited area. So this is on record, it's in the House debates, we can see what the intent of the bill was. Now, what do we see under Clause 3 of the bill that the government is providing? It says that public works may be carried out within the prohibited area. What are the public works? Of course, they assure us it's only infrastructure works, construction necessary for the safety and security of the public. But there is a lot of ambiguity in this. Who decides what is necessary for the safety and security of the public? We look at the cabinet note that's been issued by the Ministry of Culture. It gives two examples that are very instructive. One is to build an elevated road near Akbar's tomb in Agra so as to facilitate traffic. Now I ask you, Mr. Chairman, can we imagine the damage that a road right next to Akbar's tomb can cause? The damage that will be caused to any 400, 500-year-old Mughal monument when you have automobile fumes that are coming to the buildings? What is the second example they've given? They've given the construction of a railway line near the Rani Ki Vav, which is actually in Gujarat in the Prime Minister's state. It is a unique stepwell built in the 11th century by King Bhimdev. This has been listed as a UNESCO heritage site. They want to construct a railway line in front of it. They want to create construction debris. The irony, Mr. Chairman, is this very site just last year was declared the cleanest iconic place in India at a conference presided over by Prime Minister Narendra Modi. I wonder how he would feel that the cleanest iconic site is now going to be threatened by a railway line running through it. Has the government done its homework before presenting this bill? I find that this kind of very liberal application of public works is very worrying. It will affect the safety of the monuments, it will affect the security of the monuments, and it will affect the aesthetics of the monuments. The fact is that historical structures and archaeological remains are always the most susceptible to any kind of heavy vibration from construction, road building and so on, chemical effects, mechanical stresses in the area, and construction within the prohibited area can severely damage the monuments beyond repair. On top of that, you ask an archaeologist, I consulted some archaeologists. They say within this area there are unexcavated structural remains, going back to the ancient monuments. The whole idea is that any construction activity will irreversibly damage both the monument and the future structural investigations in archaeology you may want to do. Even now, as we know, for example, in the whole Ram Janmabhoomi controversy, the ASI, by digging around the foundations of the Babri Masjid, had found the ruined pillars of an old temple. Now, if you had built a road right past the Babri Masjid, you would never have known this. You have to understand that modern construction also prevents future archaeology. Now, I know what my friend the minister is going to reply. He's going to say, don't worry, my friend. He's going to say, nothing can be done until the National Monuments Authority is satisfied that construction may take place. Well, what is this National Monuments Authority? It is a part of the government, number one. Number two, it does not have the mechanism, the staffing or the expertise to determine the feasibility of projects. It does not have the ability to look at alternative routes for public construction. That's not its business. The mandate of the National Monuments Authority cannot be to determine what should be the best place to put a highway. On top of that, they're a department of the government. Their role is only to give recommendations to the government. They cannot give orders to the government. The government is empowered to overrule them. And once the government overrules them, that is the end of the matter. NMA has given its recommendation. Government has said this is important, and that would be the end of that. It places arbitrary powers, Mr. Chairman, in the hands of the government to actually threaten our historical heritage and our archaeological monuments. The NMA does not have the human resources to conduct surveys, reports, or assessments. There is a lack of financial resources to hire outside experts. Even the organization itself is supposed to have 10 members, and the Minister of Culture knows perfectly well he only has 3 members left now. He has not even hired and replaced 7 of the 10 members of the NMA. I would like to refer to an exchange in this House 1 month ago. There was a question asked to the Minister on the 18th of December 2017, the Lok Sabha, about how many monuments have been encroached. He answered 321 monuments have been encroached under the present law, and he wants to weaken the law. Let me tell you, sir, the CAG report of 2013 revealed there is such a severe shortage of staff in the ASI to preserve and protect monuments in India that out of the 1,655 monuments the ASI studied in scrutinizing the reports and physically inspected, 546 had been encroached. There is such a lack of basic manpower in the ASI that we don't even have one monument attendant per Indian monument. They only have 2,500 and there are 7,500 monuments. Mr. Chairman, in 2009, I'll just take 2 minutes, sir. In 2009, the ASI had an expert committee that looked at the possibility of construction near Humayun's tomb, and they said, yes, go ahead. It took the Delhi High Court to stop it. The Delhi High Court had to stop a construction approved by the ASI and the government. Can we trust our monuments in the hands of the ASI, the NMA, and the government of India if this is their attitude? One more last example, sir. Section 20E of the existing Act mandates the enactment of heritage bylaws. Again, our Minister of Culture on the 10th of April 2017 replied that no bylaws have been prepared under the section. So even without basic controls in place, the Minister of Culture has given greater priority to clearing projects than to preserving monuments. The Ministry of Culture has in effect been reduced by this bill into a clearing house for the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways. That is what is happening with this bill, sir. I want to conclude, Mr. Chairman, half a minute. I do appreciate the need to balance heritage conservation with development. We are not against development. We are in favor of sensible development. We want to have development in places where our precious heritage and history will not be destroyed and damaged. Even in Lutyens, Delhi, where most of the ministers in this cabinet live, there is a ban on constructing overhead metro lines because it will spoil the aesthetics of the place. We seem to care more about Lutyens, Delhi's aesthetic appeal than thousands of monuments across our country which are being jeopardized by this very irresponsible bill. For this reason, sir, I would have recommended that it be submitted to a committee of historians, architects and archaeologists for their views, failing which we have no choice but to oppose this bill. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.